afternoon, everyone. I'm Shonan. Thank you all for being here. And thanks, Circa, for offering me this opportunity to share my research and seek advices from all the experts here. And I also want to express my gratitude to many Circa friends for your help and support during the preparation of the presentation and my stay as a visiting research fellow in Circa. I'm really grateful to be here. The topic I'm going to present today is titled From Food Nutrition to Food Security to Food and Nutrition Security: How to Rethink the Linkages Between Malnutrition and the Food System. So the title is really too long. So one of the reasons is that this is a part of my ongoing dissertation project. So I don't really have a good answer for this question at this point. As a result, the goal of this presentation is really trying to open up an issue for discussion and for any advices from all of you. So the central issue I'm going to talk about today is the linkage between nutrition and agriculture over the overall food system. So the presentation will be separated into two parts. So in the first part, I will briefly talk about the terminological transition from food security to food and nutrition security. In the past decade, so we can see many NGOs and governments began to use food and nutrition security, or food security and nutrition, to replace the original term of food security. But why, and what does this really mean? I think there are two issues relating to this transition. The first one is the paradigm shift from hunger to malnutrition. And the other issue is the rise of nutrition-sensitive agriculture. So I will talk about these two issues first, and then come back to consider the difficulties to come up with a coherent food and nutrition security framework. And based on the discussion in the first part, then in the second part, I hope to provide some thoughts about how to rethink the linkages between nutrition and agriculture from a sociological perspective. In the end, I think I will have some time to receive your questions, comments, feedbacks, and any insights. So the transition from food security to food and nutrition security actually represents a shift of emphasis from hunger to malnutrition. The best example of this transition may be the comparison of United Nations Millennium Goals, a Millennium Development Goals, or MDG, and the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDG. So in 2000, when UN officially published the MDG, the first goal is to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. Under this goal, one of the targets is to reduce half of the proportion of people who suffer from hunger. So 15 years later, so UN published the SDG. This time, the issue of hunger is put under the second goal, and the entire second goal of SDG is end hunger, achieve food security and improve nutrition, and promote sustainable agriculture. So, as the comparison shows, there are several changes from MDG to SDG in terms of the issue of hunger. First, poverty and hunger are no longer under the same goal. Second, improving nutrition becomes a part of a goal. And finally, agriculture now shares the same goal with hunger and nutrition. The transition of the focus from hunger to malnutrition becomes even clearer if we compare the indicators proposed to measure these two goals. So in MDG, there are mainly two indicators about hunger. The first one is the prevalence of underweight children under 5 years of age. The second one is the proportion of population below minimum level of dietary energy consumption. As you can see here, both indicators focus only on calorie or energy deficiency. In contrast, in SDG, the measurement is more complicated. To begin with, there are two targets about hunger and malnutrition now. So the first one is, by 2030, end hunger and ensure access to all people, in particular the poor and people in vulnerable situations, including infants, to safe, nutritious, and sufficient food all year round. So you may notice that this target is actually based on the FAO's definition of food security. And there are two indicators for this target. So one measures calorie deficiency, the other measures food insecurity. The second target under SDG Goal 2 is by 2030, end all forms of malnutrition, including achieving by 2025 the internationally agreed target on starving and wasting in children under 5 years of age and address the nutritional needs of adolescent girls, pregnant and lactating women and older persons. And there are also two official indicators for this target. Both of them focus on children under 5 years old. One indicator is about chronic undernutrition, and the other one tries to address the issue of overconsumption and underconsumption of calories. Actually, so during the process, UN developed the indicators for SDG. Several additional indicators were proposed during the meeting, and most of those proposed indicators address two additional issues. One is about micronutrients deficiency, particularly among women and children. The other is about dietary diversity. So I'm not sure whether these indicators didn't become the official indicators. But overall, let me quickly conclude my discussion here. So from the comparison, we could see some major differences between hunger and malnutrition. First, the original targets of hunger only care about calorie deficiency. On the contrary, the focus of malnutrition particularly foreground the multiple forms of malnutrition. So what are these different forms of malnutrition? We can have a quick look overview here from the 2017 Global Nutrition Report. So as you can see, there are many types. And overall, there are calorie deficiency, different kinds of micronutrients deficiency, and overconsumption of calorie and some associated non-communicative diseases. Second, traditionally, hunger is recognized as resulting from poverty, and that's why increasing income is always the main goal of agricultural development. But the relationship between poverty and different forms of malnutrition are more complicated. Malnutrition may also be the cause of poverty. For example, nutritionists have discovered that the nutritional condition of children in their first 1,000 days, which is from mother's pregnancy to 2 years old, are crucial to their physical and cognitive development. In other words, if we do not address the issue of malnutrition during this crucial period, these children may not be able to develop their full capacity in the future, and that may lead to poverty. Furthermore, we also need to consider the interaction between different types of malnutrition. In some situations, an intervention targeting one type of malnutrition may lead to the occurrence of the other one. For example, an anthropologist discovered that in a community in Guatemala where obesity is a serious issue, people tend to see vitamin A fortified sugar as the healthy food and add one more spoon of sugar to their coffee. So, in other words, an intervention for vitamin A deficiency now may become a contributing factor for obesity in the future. But in other conditions, addressing one type of malnutrition may prevent another one from happening. For example, some scholars argue that stunting in childhood may lead to obesity in adulthood. That means by reducing child stunting, we may also reduce the obesity rate in the future. So there are other examples, but I will skip it now. Third, so the connection between dietary health and the food system is being foregrounded in SDG 2. And this links to what I'm going to discuss next about nutrition-sensitive agriculture. So, but before getting into that, let me quickly address another question. So what are reasons for this shift from hunger to malnutrition? Based on my understanding now, there are several reasons. The first one is the prevalence of double burden of malnutrition in the developing countries. In general, double burden of malnutrition means the prevalence of undernutrition and overweight in one country. Nutritionists began to notice the issue of nutrition transition and overweight and double burden of malnutrition in late 1990s. Right now, according to the 2016 Global Nutrition Report, more than half of the countries in the world are encountering double burden of malnutrition, including most of the Southeast Asian countries. The second reason is the advances within nutritional science, especially about the life course nutrition and the importance of maternal and infant nutrition. And the third, another possible reason is the shift of focus in the international agricultural research field. So due to the lack of funding in traditional fields, agricultural researchers shifted the focus to global health related issues in 1990s to 2000, the early 2000s. And this also contributed to the rise of a nutrition sensitive agriculture. Okay. So at the same time, this paradigm shift from hunger to malnutrition, there's also a new trend in the international agricultural development field, the so-called nutrition-sensitive agriculture. There have been many discussions about how the trend emerged at the first place, but I'm not going to talk about this now. So I will only briefly introduce what nutrition-sensitive agriculture is as a foundation for my discussion in following sections. So before I briefly introduce the nutrition-sensitive agriculture, I want to introduce this new e-learning course in the FAO website titled Nutrition and the Food System, created in late 2016. And this book titled Nutrition-Sensitive Agriculture in Practice, published also by FAO in 2017. So the course and the book are based on the same materials, I think. And I think they are very good starting points for those who hope to understand more about nutrition-sensitive agriculture. And as you can imagine, FAO plays an important role of promoting nutrition-sensitive agriculture. One of the important events is the second International Conference on Nutrition, or ICN2, co-held by FAO and WHO in 2014. During this conference, FAO announced to mainstream nutrition by including it in each of its 5 strategic objectives and maximizing the impact of food and agriculture system on nutrition. So FAO's efforts are only a part of the global trend to strengthen the linkage between agriculture and nutrition in the past 2 decades. I took this chart from the FAO e-learning course. So this chart shows several important meetings and conferences held during the past decade to mobilize nutrition-sensitive agriculture. Additionally, many new NGOs and collaborations were also established during the past decade, and some old NGOs also began to focus on this issue. And there are also many scholarly articles published in different journals discussing this trend, including at least 2 papers written by UPOB scholars. Okay. Now let me briefly introduce some basic ideas of nutrition-sensitive agriculture. So the first one, nutrition-sensitive is actually in contrast to nutrition-specific. So this is a conceptual framework of malnutrition developed by UNICEF. So in this framework, there are different levels of causes. So one is immediate cause. So it's here.
The immediate cause.
So the nutrition specific actions are referring to actions for these immediate causes. But these immediate causes are the results of some underlying causes and basic causes. And this is where the nutrition sensitive actions could step in. So, and as you can see in this conceptual framework, there are several agriculture related causes. So in other words, nutrition sensitive means not directly solving the nutrition specific problems, but may contribute to some underlying or basic causes of malnutrition. Moreover, this framework also clearly indicates that multi-sectoral efforts are necessary to really tackle the issue of malnutrition. I will come back to this later. Second, from the perspective of the agricultural development, nutrition-sensitive agriculture also indicates a transition from agriculture which focuses on quantity or yield to agriculture focusing on quality or nutritional values. So there are two agricultural scientists. They published a paper in 1999, and they have a good quote about what this transition is about. So as they say in the paper, agriculture has never made adequate and balanced nutrition output and express goal of its production systems. The nutrition and health communities have never considered using agriculture as a primary goal in their programs. A new paradigm for agriculture and nutrition is now needed. So of course, if whether this is a new paradigm remains a topic for discussion. And third, so since the promotion of the nutrition-sensitive agriculture in more than 10 years ago, there are also some advances on of how to implement this idea and what this really refers to. A major progress is the shift of the focus from originally only focus on food production to later also considering the entire food system. So I also took this figure from the Eland course. So as you can see, this is a food system. And in the middle, it's important, this is a food environment. So this is also a relatively new idea. So food environment is an important medium for the individual household and the structural food system. And overall, over these years, FAO has collected different types of nutrition-sensitive innovations as different phases of food system. So for example, in food production, there are different types of innovations. And in food handling and storage and processing, there are also some. And food trade and marketing. And I think this should be more and more important. And also consumers demand, food preparation and preferences, and some cost-cutting issues. So because I want to save some time for discussion, so I will speed up a little bit. So after the basic understanding of this paradigm shift from hunger to malnutrition and the rise of nutrition-sensitive agriculture, now we may consider how to update the food security framework. So now we could come back to consider this question. What a new food and nutrition security framework may look like? And this question actually attracts lots of interesting discussions and debates. But first, let me give a brief clarification here. So, similar to the conceptual framework of malnutrition, nutrition security is actually an entirely different framework from food security. The basic framework for nutrition security at least, including these few elements, including food, water, hygiene, sanitation, health system, and caring practices. So they are really different from the original food security framework. Actually, a scholar has proposed a popular framework indicating the relationship between the original food security and nutrition security. And as you can see here, so from the perspective of the household level nutrition security, the traditional food security is only the foundation of the nutrition security, the big one. And it's even not the most important foundation. And some other scholars and NGOs, they really tried to come up with a definition of food and nutrition security. So for example, during a UN meeting in 2013, a doctor who proposed a new definition of food and nutrition security like this. So it's food and nutrition security exists when all people at all times have physical, social, and economic access to food which is consumed in sufficient quantity and quality to meet their dietary needs and food preferences, and is supported by an environment of adequate sanitation, health services, and care, allowing for a healthy and active life. So it's a really complicated definition. So at least in the short term, I don't think this kind of complicated definition is helpful to mobilize any critical interventions. Instead, I think it may be more useful if we begin with the food system perspective and only focus on what kinds of framework could help us to mobilize the food system for nutrition. So, then we need to come back to understand the creation of the food security framework. As you may know, the food security framework has evolved over time since its creation in 1974. It was built on the paradigm of hunger and focused only on quantity of food. And over the updates in the past three decades, the current food security framework includes four aspects. So that's food supply, or food availability, food access, and normally it's separated into two types, physical and economic, and food utilization and food stability. So although there are four aspects in this framework, normally the most important element is access. But still, the basic idea of access does not clearly indicate what kind of food to access. And there are many ways to revise this focus. For example, in a recent UNICEF regional report on national security in ASEAN, so they propose a quite good revisal of this food and nutrition security. So they say, in order to achieve food and nutrition security for all, for food availability, so which includes sufficient quantities of food, and food access, so that means sufficient resources to obtain appropriate food for a nutritious diet, stability, and food use. So food use means appropriate use based on knowledge of basic nutrition and care, as well as adequate water and sanitation. So as you can see here, it is really an attempt to bring in the focus on nutrition to the original food security framework. But I think there should be another way to readdress the issue of nutrition and quality by adding more aspects in the original food security framework. For example, I think one example is that we could consider to add food diversity as another dimension in the original food security framework. So that could address the issue of diversity from production to consumption. And yeah, I will talk about that later. Additionally, from a food system perspective, the retailer's market plays a crucial role for the issue of malnutrition. But there is no clear focus on those market practices, such as marketing or food labeling in the original food security framework. And finally, the aspect of food utilization should be more important, but there's a need for a better operational focus on this aspect. So overall, I think there's a need for a new framework. So in the second part of the presentation, I hope to provide some additional thoughts about the agricultural nutrition linkage from a sociological perspective. So overall, I suggest that we may need to pay more attention to three kinds of perspectives. For now, I call them systematic, ecological, historical, structural, and cultural political perspectives. So the first one is a systematic ecological perspective. As I mentioned earlier, FAO has adopted the food system as the main framework for nutrition-sensitive agriculture and focus on different aspects of the food system other than only on food production. In addition to the food system perspective, some scholars also try to make a case for the connection between agricultural biodiversity and human health, especially dietary diversity, such as this very interesting book about agricultural diversity and a healthy diet. Another similar approach is a framework called eco-nutrition, developed by some nutritionists. So a basic definition of eco-nutrition is the interaction among the field of agriculture, ecology, and human nutrition. And so this is just a chart to indicate the interaction between these three aspects, but I will skip that for now. Okay, so the second perspective I call is historical structural perspective. So the main idea of this perspective is that we may need to acquire more understanding about the structural changes in history. Especially before we consider how agriculture may contribute to nutrition, we may need to evaluate how much harm the agricultural development has done to nutrition. In other words, before we hope to utilize the food system to promote nutrition, we need to know what are some negative consequences caused by the previous agricultural development. So indeed, the linkage between nutrition and agriculture have existed since the beginning of human civilization. The eradication of famine, chronic hunger, and malnutrition is never a linear history. On the contrary, history shows that every time human beings transition into a new type of food production system, the transition is always followed by a degradation of nutritional conditions for particular social groups in the society. For example, recent archaeological evidence indicates that when human beings transformed from hunting and gathering society to the settlement and agricultural-based society, their dietary diversity decreased, so as their nutritional conditions. Similarly, the Industrial Revolution beginning in Britain in the 18th century pushed a large group of peasants into urban areas. While working in the industries in the city, those households were also trapped into severe food insecure conditions. So you can see that in many novels. The transformation of the mode of agricultural production also impacts the rural population. Since the colonial period, and especially in the past two centuries, when the global trade of food commodities facilitated agrarian communities to transform from subsistence farming to commodity farming, particularly monocropping farming. The transformation was also followed with a higher level of food insecurity and lower level of dietary diversity due to the dependence on staples purchased from the market. So it's from the physical access to economic access to food. And in recent years, the westernization of diets and the global expansion of supermarkets in different developing countries are also recognized by some scholars as one of the main causes of obesity and non-communicative diseases in those countries. So overall, we may say that with the historical formation of the globalized food system, our production and consumption patterns have been changing, and so has our dietary health. And there are also other pathways that the food system may have negative impacts on food security or nutrition. So one of them is the price volatility of the global market, like the 2007 to 2008 global food crisis. And the other one is the soil degradation caused by the intensive agriculture. So there are more and more discussions and debates about this issue. That is whether nutritional values in crops have really decreased over time because of the intensive agriculture. So to conclude, from this historical structural perspective, nutrition-sensitive agriculture is only one particular phase of the nutrition-agriculture linkage in the history. And the question in front of us then is that how we could learn from previous experiences and make some policies for the future generation.
And the third
and the final perspective is a cultural critical perspective. Particularly, there are three issues I want to discuss briefly, just briefly. So the first one is the impact of the agricultural policy making on nutrition interventions or food aid. So I will only mention two examples. The first one is foreign food aid. So foreign food aid is very popular, especially during 1950s to 60s. Although these foreign aids aim to help countries suffering from hunger and famine, food aid policies are actually closely tied to the agricultural policies in those donor countries, and also have a large impact on those recipient countries. So on the one end, most of the donor countries intended to get rid of their surplus crops to stabilize their domestic food market. On the other end, the donation of those surplus crops may also provide opportunities for these donor countries to create international food markets. So one classic example is the Food for Peace program of the USAID. After World War II, the US government designed the Food for Peace program and exported wheat to other countries as international aid. And this type of in-kind food aid not only undermined the formation of the local food production and markets, it also impacted the dietary habits in those recipient countries. So Taiwan is a good example. So Taiwan was the main recipient country of USAID in East Asia at that time. And to encourage the rice consuming citizens to eat wheat-based product, the Taiwan government at that time invented the wheat consumption traditions and mobilized different kinds of campaigns to encourage Taiwanese citizens to consume more wheat-based products like noodles and bread. And eventually, the result is the decreasing trend of rice consumption and production in Taiwan. So in general, there are lots of debates about the choices between in-kind donation and cash-based transfer, but let's keep it now. And so overall, no. So the second example is in the local context. So even in the local context, nutritional interventions may also intertwine with the policy of agricultural development. An interesting example comes from Indonesia. According to a sociologist, Aya Kimura study. So when Indonesia encountered the huge pressure to open their wheat market, the Indonesian government designed a very particular rule of the mandatory wheat fortification of vitamin A as a strategy to prohibit wheat imports from other countries so that the local wheat industry could keep their market. So overall, that means we need to acknowledge that agricultural development and nutritional assistance do not always share the same goal, and sometimes it's contradictory. So recognizing their differences could help us to have a better policy design. Okay. The second cultural political issue is the impact influence of food industry. And there are already many discussion about this issue, especially in the US and other developed countries. So I will also only raise two kinds of examples here. So the first example is the corporate influence on governmental regulations, such as the dietary guideline. So this book, The Food Politics, so this is a classic book about this issue. So the book reveals how the official dietary guidelines published by the US government are influenced largely by different interest groups, and particularly different food industries like meat and corn and other and milk and other industry over time, so it's historical. And so the another example is how the food industry has influenced the development of hunger relief network in the US. So as this recent book by Andrew Fisher argues, the hunger relief network in the US, it's a very big hunger relief network by many local food banks. So the hunger relief network has been integrated into the food commodity chain. So it becomes a way for the supermarkets to get rid of their food surplus. So in other words, the hunger relief network has built a strong alliance with the food industry and constructed the surplus food disposal chain from the supermarket to food bank and sponsored by the trucks of the supermarket. So anyway, it becomes another way for the supermarkets to generate profit. So with the rise of nutrition-sensitive food system and the popularity of the idea public-private partnership, I think there will be more and more cooperations between NGOs or governments with food corporations. As a result, I think it may be necessary to understand the existing power of transnational food corporations and set up better guidelines for this kind of partnership. There are already some discussions about the regulations of nutritional labeling or marketing, but I think this is not enough. So the last issue I'm going to talk about is about some negative impact of the extensive focus on nutritional science itself. So this is really a relatively new issue in the US, Western Europe, Australia, and other countries. So my intention to introduce these discussions here is not to undermine the legitimacy of nutritional science, but to provide some lessons from other countries so that we may avoid their mistakes. So one potential negative impact is what we call the reductive ideology of nutritional science. So there are two types of argument. So the first one is because of the focus on nutrients, people then tend to reduce food into the combination of nutrients and reduce human health into many measurable biomarkers. For example, so we will see milk has a benefit for bone fracture, and then we reduce milk as normally the nutrients calcium, and bone fracture as the biomarker bone density. And so this is one kind of reductive ideology. And the other similar argument is that, so when we tend to understand food only with the quantifiable categories such as calorie or nutrient, then those other categories that are not quantifiable, like culture, taste, or geography, may be gradually marginalized or even disappear. And so moral assumptions is another critique of dietary knowledge overall, but I will skip this for now. Okay, so there are also many new ideas about within and beyond nutritional academia to rethink what nutrition and dietary health should be or could be. So there are two kinds. So one is doing nutrition science differently. So there are many initiatives, many new by some nutritionists to promote new kinds of knowledge production within nutritional science. And in other ways, I call it other ways of knowing healthy eating. So that means we could also try to incorporate knowledge from different medical systems or cultural practices and varying the traditional knowledge and dietary cultures. Yeah. Okay. And so overall, I hope these different perspectives could help us to consider those innovations during the policy making and innovation design process. I also think these perspectives highlight the importance of cross-disciplinary collaborations, and not only between agricultural scientists and nutritionists, but also including perspectives from social scientists and humanities scholars. So I want to close my presentation with just one example. So this is the example I came across recently during a meeting in Serhat. So the example is about school feeding program in the Philippines. And it seems there are two emerging models now. So one is homegrown school meal program. And in some countries, this means to advocate to buy food from local communities for the school feeding program. And another similar model is to utilize school gardening to supplement school feeding program. And this is the model adopted by the Serhat School at Home Gardening Project. In contrast, some universities and NGOs are developing a centralized kitchen model in the Philippines. A famous case is the collaboration between Ateneo University and Venezuela City. So the idea is to establish one central kitchen to serve all the public schools within the city. An NGO called Gawat Galinga, they also developed a fairly quite successful program based on this central kitchen model. So this is their website. So the question for me is that, so how may we evaluate these two models through a food system perspective and other perspective? So I don't answer now, and I don't think there's the only answer. But we could imagine that these two kinds of models will mobilize different types of food system. And I think that's what we need to consider. Okay, I will end my presentation for now. Thank you again for your listening to my presentation. Mon ami, bonsoir.